never tease when mother tells you no, dear. And there's many other pointers that I will mention. Remember this, it's very true. All things are not good for you. I hope that you are paying close attention. Suppose that someone of your little playmates has something that you would like to own. Now, if you say, dear mother, may I have one just like that? And mother says, no, dear, don't weep and moan. We can't have everything we want, dear. And there's many other pointers that I will mention. You would not care for anything if you could have everything. I hope that you are paying close attention. It's natural to want most things we see, dears. Some of us go all through life that way. Wanting, asking, teasing, fretting, never satisfied, being most unhappy every day. So do your best to break the teasing habit. Oh, there's many other pointers that I could mention. Never tease and pout all day. Suppose your face should freeze that way. I thank you for your very kind attention. But of smaller children, never take advantage. They like to play their games just as well as you. Supposing someone big should come and take your toys away, why, you'd think it was an awful thing to do. Now, wouldn't you? So enjoy your fun, but don't impose on others. And there's many other pointers that I could mention. If you for better manners strive, just heed this chapter number 5. I thank you for your very kind attention.
Uncle Don's appeal to children all over the country was an early phenomenon of radio. In 1929, Uncle Don was included in the Blue Ribbon list of radio programs considered to be the cream of the industry. That was the same year another radio phenomenon was developing in the obscurity of a small radio station in Baltimore. He was billed as the Warbling Banjoist. No radio personality before or since has endeared himself to the American public more than Arthur Godfrey, whose personal warmth and sincerity are evident in this touching recitation.
Between the innocence of babyhood and the dignity of manhood, we find a delightful creature called a boy. Boys come in assorted sizes, weights, and colors, but all boys have the same creed: to enjoy every second of every minute of every hour of every day, and to protest with noise, their only weapon, when their last minute is finished and the adult males pack them off to bed at night. Boys are found everywhere. On top of, underneath, inside of, climbing on, swinging from, running around, or jumping to. Mothers love them. Little girls hate them. Older sisters and brothers tolerate them. Adults ignore them, and heaven protects them. A boy is truth with dirt on its face, wisdom with bubblegum in its hair, and the hope of the future with a frog in its pocket. When you're busy, a boy is an inconsiderate, bothersome, intruding jangle of noise. When you want him to make a good impression, his brain turns to jelly. Or else he becomes a savage, sadistic jungle creature bent on destroying the world and himself with it. A boy is a composite. He has the appetite of a horse, the digestion of a sword swallower, the energy of a pocket-sized atomic bomb, and the curiosity of a cat. He has the lungs of a dictator, the imagination of a Paul Bunyan, the shyness of a violet, the audacity of a steel trap, the enthusiasm of a firecracker, and when he makes something, he has 5 thumbs on each paw. He likes ice cream, knives, saws, Christmas, comic books, the boy across the street, woods, water in its natural habitat, large animals, dad, trains, Saturday mornings, and fire engines. He's not much for Sunday school, company, schools, books without pictures, music lessons, neckties, barbers, girls, overcoats, adults, or bedtime. Nobody else is so early to rise or so late to supper. Nobody else gets so much fun out of trees and dogs and breezes. Nobody else can cram into one pocket a rusty knife, a half-eaten apple, 3 feet of string, an empty Bull Durham sack, 2 gumdrops, 6 cents, a slingshot, the chunk of some unknown substance, and a genuine supersonic code ring with a secret compartment. A boy is a magical creature. You can lock him out of your workshop, but you can't lock him out of your heart. You can get him out of your study, but you can't get him out of your mind. Might as well give up. He's your captor, your jailer, your boss, your master. He's a freckle-faced, pint-sized, cat-chasing bundle of noise. But when you come home at night with only the shattered pieces of your hopes and dreams, he can mend them like new with those 2 magic words. Hi, Dan.
As further proof of his impact on the audience, it was Arthur Godfrey who almost single-handedly revived public interest in a musical instrument which had been a national favorite during the fun-loving 1920s, the ukulele. The entertainer first responsible for its popularity during those roaring years was Cliff Edwards, best known as Ukulele Ike.
Say it's only a paper moon, sailing over a cardboard sea, but it wouldn't be make-believe if you believed in me. Yes, it's only a canvas sky hanging over a muslin tree, but it wouldn't be make-believe if you believed in me. Without your love, it's a honky-tonk parade. Without your love, it's a melody played in a penny arcade. It's a Barnum and Bailey world, just as phony as it can be. But it wouldn't be make-believe if you believed in me.
From the Ziegfeld Follies of 1919, to George Gershwin's Lady Be Good in 1924, to the Hollywood Review of 1929, to the Columbia Variety Hour in 1934, to the voice of Jiminy Cricket, and new success in television, Ukulele Ike has been one of America's favorite troubadours for more than 4 decades. No mention of radio troubadours would be complete without the name of Morton Downey, who held forth as radio's most popular Irish tenor during the 1930s and continued to star on radio into the 1950s. His Rose of Tralee brought a tear to many a smiling Irish eye.
The pale moon was rising above the green mountain. The sun was declining beneath the blue sea. When I strayed with my love to the pure crystal fountain that stands in the beautiful vale of Tralee. Though lovely and fair as the rose of the summer, yet was not her beauty alone that won me. Oh no, 'twas the truth in her eye ever dawning that made me love Mary. was the truth in her eye ever dawning that made me